liminal emptiness of the universe begs for entropy. As particles amass and drift apart over immeasurable depths of time, space itself becomes a static, unsurpassable obstacle. Even light itself will eventually leave the inhospitable universe. The vast majority of existence will become nothing more than a lightless, timeless playground of the gravitational forces of black holes. There's only one force able to fight the looming progression of permanent entropy. Life. The brief, rapid blur of life can alter and destroy worlds in comparative moments. Its desiderate lust for its own longevity leads intelligence outward until it finds itself faced with that entropy, that nothingness. And, in the face of that inevitable end, life instead looks inward, clinging to artificial minds, ticking once a millennia, drawing the very rotational energy of black holes to think. It's there that these deathless gods muse on their mortal origins. That arcane, transient universe that only exists in fading memory. Oh, to see this time of change, of random chance, when the universe was alive. Our sun is a G-type main sequence star. It's not particularly large, but is fairly stable over long periods of time, given its output. Although it's bright to the point of appearing white, in a perfect blackbody situation, it actually peaks at a tealish green. In a sense, our sun is green. However, because it's not a perfect blackbody, this color isn't outwardly noticeable and can be overwhelmed by violet and infrared thanks to radiation. Still, its peak remains an integral factor of its output regarding the progression of life. Perhaps this star is a similar G-type main sequence star. Nothing out of the ordinary, nothing outstanding. Perhaps it peaks at yellow for no other reason than it being my favorite color. As the golden star formed, a disk of material that escaped its direct grasp unwillingly followed it into the freshly illuminated darkness. The universe was new, but old and cool enough to support stable objects. Like a centrifuge, different elements gather in messy layers. The heavier elements trend near the star, and lighter, more slippery elements wisp along the trailing edge. This is why rocky planets occur inward, and gaseous planets secure their positions outward. The golden star, like ours, hosts its own collection of freshly gathered planets. During planetary formation, a barrage of shrapnel plagues the system. As material clusters together, it also collides in a near-constant flurry. Early large objects even eject smaller clusters thanks to their newfound gravitational influence. All of this chaos warps orbits and destroys worlds. No planet without protection from such incessant bombardment could ever maintain life. This is the Shepherd, the golden star's inwardmost gas giant. It's the second most influential object in the star system. If it had its way, it would have grown into the system's star. Its similarity to our Jupiter is not a coincidence. Its distance from the golden star lends it a hoarded abundance of hydrogen and helium. Its warm hues emerge from trace elements such as sulfur, which is particularly active within its atmosphere. Further gas planets are polluted with the harsh blues of methane. This is similar to trace elements coloring otherwise clear diamonds. The Shepherd's surface is striped with clearly defined convection patterns, with clouds on scales larger than most planets. Its weather is among the most inhospitable in the solar system, battered and bruised with blemishing storms that rage for hundreds of years. This failed star has grown vengeful. The only light that descends past its surface is that from the ceaseless roar of lightning that cuts miles into its abyssal atmosphere. There is no silence in this world. Its magnetic field is so intensely powerful that auroras exceed the grandeur of entire planets. Piercing blue crowns adorn this malignant quintessence of spite. Its abhorrent disregard for its star has led it to profoundly alter the behavior of its solar kin. The Shepherd has formed a legion of millions. A belt of once free, chaotic objects has been herded into an obedient swarm of asteroids and other subplanetary objects. Those unwilling to obey have since succumbed to a fate of ejection, consumption, or a seat directly under the Shepherd's boot in the form of one of its dozens of nameless satellites. The Shepherd's overwhelming influence just so happens to protect the inner planets from debris and objects with inconsistent orbits. Life will go on to live in reverence of the Shepherd's indifferent omnipotence. The inner planets have yet to reach their equilibrium. Many young worlds have lost their fights for dominance. Here we have a rocky planet, a little smaller than the familiar Mars. It formed close enough to the Golden Star to be extremely metal-rich, especially in iron. Ruddy stains on its surface prove that oxidization, or rusting, has been wearing its surface consistently. Atmospheric oxygen is rare in high concentrations and can be used as evidence of life as a byproduct of photosynthesis. However, this world's atmosphere is fleeting, and the little oxygen remaining comes from its barely present water cycle. Small worlds aren't often stable enough for life, and this one has been teetering off the edge for thousands of years. Other planets have been abusing its slow orbit to gradually cast it further away from its star. This is our planet, Lapis. It's both larger and more massive than Earth. Because of this, its gravity is nearly twice as intense as our home. This will have massive ramifications for how complex life can evolve. As it cools, its geothermal activity begins to slow. Water vapor in its atmosphere freezes across its surface, increasing albedo, reflecting more of the Golden Star's light away and cooling its surface faster. Quite literally, Lapis is experiencing a snowball effect. Although it survived its solar system's age of bombardment, its scarred, icy surface debates a permanent face as its innards slow to a whimpering halt. A dead world drifts lifeless in the dark void. That is, until a dense little world is thrust into its orbit. One fateful pass by, Lapis dragged the iron world out of its slow orbit just as it pulled Lapis closer to their sun. As the tug-of-war settled, Lapis had captured a moon. Tidal forces subjected by the dense satellite reawakened its plate tectonics and tore its ice sheets asunder. Our world's heart began to beat again, just as the iron moon finally found its place in the star system. Lapis's icy surface gradually melts away, revealing a crust composition similar to that of Earth, but with notably higher deposits of a silvery white metal known as calcium. As water is released from glaciers and deep within the crust, it pools over the planet's revived surface and fills its atmosphere with vapor. Lapis has become a water world. The iron moon beckons Lapis's waters, pulling tides across its face. The power of wind and rain erodes staggering canyons into the bare rock. There is no soil. There is no sand. Lapis's surface has become a smooth carving. Minerals wash from the land's crust and into the sea, churning inorganic nutrients in a foaming, fertile froth. As the tides wax and wane, rivers, streams, lakes, and puddles flood and dry like clockwork. For a single moment, materials randomly aligned in the perfect form of a nucleic acid. Perhaps this wasn't the first time. Maybe it took a million tries, or more, but this time it didn't succumb to entropy. This time it was enveloped by a microscopic bubble laped with naturally occurring lipids. A phospholipid bilayer that shrouded its innards from the outside. And this time, it didn't just manage to assemble more of itself. This time, it copied itself. From that moment on, time suddenly meant a great deal more than it ever had before. This world was never dead. it just had yet to be born. Life is nothing but a byproduct of an inanimate molecule. But oh, it's beautiful in all of its fleeting impermanence. As soon as the first life managed to gather materials and duplicate itself, another, more fleeting branch of life parasitized their abilities. Nothing more than a behaviorless husk surrounding a strip of genetic material, they act as viruses do on Earth, by pure chance hijacking the host into copying the parasite's genetics instead of its own. This first betrayal, the first sin of life, is a sign of great things to come. Lapis has nearly no axial tilt, and its year is balanced at around 400 Earth days. Its full rotation takes about 26 hours. On world, a year is a little over 369 days. The Iron Moon makes a full rotation and travels along its oblong orbit every 52 hours. From Lapis's perspective, the Iron Moon moves backwards across the sky, and its tides are retrograde. Passively bumping into and absorbing raw materials developed into a more methodical approach. Sulfur compounds, methane, and ammonium are slowly rotted away by chemosynthetic organisms in every ripened nook and cranny across and inside the world. As tectonic activity swashes and recycles Lapis's ancestral pitted surface, cumulated granitic rock buoyantly and stubbornly floats atop the planet's mantle, while denser, more subdued basaltic rock recesses downward as oceanic floor. Continental plates will drown these heavy, recessive plates in the mantle upon collision, but they're limited in size. The world's vast, watery depths consume much of its continents as they fight for air. With the advent of photosynthesis, life can suddenly sustain extreme population density. And, with that, it now wields the power to scar its homeworld forever. Single cells have learned, or stolen, the ability to eat starlight. Because the golden star peaks at yellow, two phenotypes have achieved dominance. Yellow structures reflect away the most powerful wavelengths, and safely absorb the rest. Conversely, purple structures consume only the strongest, most damaging wavelengths, and discard the rest. Water is naturally blue. This is because blue is the hue most difficult for it to silence. Water still allows light to penetrate its depths, which is why it appears clear in low volumes. But in Lapis's seas, this dynamic allows yellow-shifted autotrophs to succeed greatly. Be it withstanding the radiation of very shallow water, or taking advantage of the deep's piercing blues in orange and brown forms. Meanwhile, purple-shifted organisms make the middle water their domain, abusing the yellow form's surface dominance to feed off of their reflected light. This explosion of photosynthetic life has stained Lapis's surface with a rich, brown sludge. Simultaneously, this new age has dammed the once worldwide anaerobic ecosystems to deep vents and caves due to its excessive pollution of oxygen. Large planets tend to be very stable, especially in maintaining an atmosphere and a strong magnetic field. Life here will be much less likely to be suddenly decimated by outside forces. The increased gravity will also provide a larger and much denser atmosphere. Though its composition is now similar to Earth's, its skies are not blue. Instead, they're a blank off-white. The color of a sky is influenced by how much material light needs to pass through before reaching the ground. Under earthly conditions, light hitting perpendicular to the surface travels straight down, carrying with it our bright blue skies. However, at a harsh angle, like sunset, light is forced through enough material to appear red. The border between these earthly extremes is a desaturated angelic haze. This is where Lapis finds itself. Because the planet's axial tilt is nearly an exact 0 degrees, the sky around its equator is nearly white, even on a cloudless day, while its poles decay into a permanent desaturated red. A warm, beckoning sky, looming over the desolate, frigid wasteland, unable to escape its incessant, endless winter. Among the earliest and most prolific of Lapis's simple life forms are tiny single cells that excrete a shell for structure and protection. It's made of calcium carbonate. A near endless supply bathes this world's surface. Innumerous in diversity, these organisms echo Earth's forams. Mindlessly consuming all life smaller than themselves, these exoforams will continue to hold the highest trophic niches for over a billion years. In that time, these tiny organisms affix carbon into stone, sealing it away as their decayed tests collect as grains of sand. Lapis has evolved into a world of white sandy beaches. So much time has elapsed that the shepherd has gained and lost a ring from the corpse of one of its moons. Eons pass with little notice to the steaming, life-filled world. Although generations are quick and plentiful, evolution through cloning is unhurried. Life has the nasty misfortune of being among the most selfish forces in the universe. The insurmountable influence of photosynthesis cannot be ignored. Previously unthinkable levels of oxygen flood Lapis's atmosphere, spiking upwards of 40% of its composition for a brief million years. This rapid change is only compounded by the exoforam slowly sequestering carbon outside of its cycle, as Lapis loses the ability to retain heat. Life has overflown its limits. Lapis's air and water currents can no longer resist the freezing of its poles as the putrid decay of death poisons every ecosystem on the planet. Lapis's first heyday has collapsed in on itself. The planet's unforgiving poles encroach toward its equator, snuffing out all but the most basic forms of life within its clutches. Greed has cost this world a reset worth billions of years. Or it nearly has. Before the ice took hold of its entire surface, peaking its albedo to a permanently frigid state, life rebounded in a more humbled manner. The poles stabilized into receded frozen caps, while the sea, no longer a frothing blanket of sludge, returned to a deep blue. Life has finally matured into an equilibrium. After billions of years of intransigent stagnation, the scene is set for more complex life to take center stage. The earliest multicellular organisms are uncoordinated clusters of cells. In this world, two distantly related lineages have achieved multicellularity. Motile cells, similar in structure to our flagellates, one line has assimilated yellow autotrophs into its being, while the other remains completely heterotrophic. They are each little more than colonial masses with a regulated pocket of water inside to help transfer nutrients. Members aimlessly flick their tails to haphazardly move the colony and to consume smaller organisms. The Vulvox-like organism reproduces by generating sister colonies within itself and releasing them by tearing apart, while the Placozoa-like organism reproduces through fission and budding. For taxonomic coherence, the autotroph's lineage will be referred to as Xanthophilifera, and the heterotroph's as Exotheria. The future is bright for these early life forms, but this time of leisurely poise will not last forever.
Hi there, my name is Candy Eggs, that is my legal name. Thank you for watching to the end of my thing. This has been a project that I've been working on for a really long time now, and I've just gotten around to recording it. Hopefully the audio isn't too horrible.